Good afternoon. I would like to welcome everybody to the first session of Conversations That Matter for the 2023-2024 academic year. My name is Dr. Justin Gamage. I'm a former faculty member in the Department of Africana Studies, and I currently serve as Chief of Staff to the CSU DH President Thomas A. Parham. So before we get started, I'm going to outline our agenda, and then we'll move into the program. But for those who are attending or streaming Conversations That Matter for the first time, this is a space that's created intentionally to engage discourse and provide discussion around topics that are confronting our campus. You'll see that our agenda today reflects that aim. For today, we will start the program by having President Parham provide a welcome for us. Then we'll move to VP Seth Chalopa to provide an overview for previous conversations that mattered. Then we'll move into an open forum that will be facilitated by Provost Spagna. Then we'll move into a section where we provide information that we feel that you all should know moving out of this space. Then we'll close it with President Parham, which will provide an overview of our strategic priorities for academic year 2023-2024. All right. So without further ado, President Parham.
Good afternoon. Come on in. We got plenty of seats. Feel free to, no need to stand. Come on, y'all. We got lots of good conversation going on. So welcome to our first Conversations That Matter on this academic year. How y'all doing? Come on in. One of the things that we have promised to do in my administration is to try to provide as much transparency as possible. We value the fact that people have opinion about things. But what I want to make sure is that we don't play the telephone game. What you talking about, Dr. P? Y'all remember the telephone game when we were all young? One person says whatever and they whisper, and by the time it gets to like the 30th person, it's a whole distorted version about what's going on. The telephone game does not serve us well if we cannot provide accurate information to the campus community about the things that matter to us most. So we try to assemble senior leadership of the campus to help answer whatever questions you have. Now, format-wise, while Dr. Gamage, and he's not a former faculty member, he didn't like revoke his faculty privilege, right? He is still a faculty member, brilliant intellect, but I've now gone into the faculty ranks to be able to grab him to be my new chief of staff. So I want to say, first of all, thank you to David Gamboa. Where did David go? Oh, there he is, right in front of me. I want to say thank you to David Gamboa, who's been serving as my interim chief of staff for the last year and a half or two. And he's now gone back to be the senior associate VP in university advancement, but managing government and external relations, et cetera. See, I'll give David some love and say thank you for all the work that he does. He is still, though, I affectionately call him my American Express card. I don't leave home without him. Whether I'm on Capitol Hill, whether I am in Sacramento, and all spots in between, he has some of the best credibility you can find. And if he can get in anywhere, any day, because he's so doggone good and trustworthy. So he will still be, right, with me as we travel the nation trying to advance this CSUDH, right, institution we are trying to stand up. But we're also blessed internally now to be able to invite Dr. Gamage to come out the faculty ranks and come over, as we used to say on the faculty side, to the dark side in administration, right? To be able to do some administrative work, because I need his intellectual horsepower in the space to be able to help me do. So I'm blessed because I now have Justin, I have David as well as this whole team, and we are working on all of your behalf. Today's format, I'm going to introduce some folk in a minute. They'll kind of go through in the way that Justin said. But what you'll find when the provost gets to you is that while we have things we are prepared to talk to you about, Conversations That Matter is really your time. So if there are things that are on your mind that are dominating your consciousness, and say, nah, we want to hear about X, let us know that, and we'll do that. If we can answer it on the spot, we will. If we can't, we'll park it for a moment, and we'll come back at a time when we can say something about that, or bring the, you know, the people with us to be able to do that. But these are all the issues that help us advance as a system. Lastly, I want to say, from my remarks, we have 20th is when we have campus convocation next week. Y'all come on in, we have seats over here, we have seats back here. When we have campus convocation next week, we want to invite folks to come there because we'll be unveiling some things going on there. But right now what we want to do is get started on conversations that matter. And what we want to do as we reflect on the year is go back and recap some of the conversations that mattered last year and what we've done so that we close the loop on those circles that we opened up. And so I'm going to introduce our Vice President for University Advancement, Eva Sefcikova, who, by the way, she and her team, along with Dean Kim and Dean Pandya, where did I see Jessica at? There she is, over there. Along with Yasmina, have just been a part of capturing the largest gift we have ever received in the history of this campus, $22.1 million. So if you want to know why she has a smile on her face, it's because that's what makes Vice Chancellors for University Advancement do that. $17 million of that goes to student scholarships, which is what we've been looking at. So that's a big deal. So without any further ado, Vice President Sefcikova.
Good afternoon. Hello and welcome, everybody. So good to see you. If you're keeping track, this is actually the fifth conversation that matters that we're having together. The last time we have seen each other, just to remind you all, was in November and December last year. And then again, we all saw each other in February and May earlier this year. And so much has happened since then, as President Parham indicated. We've had our cultural graduations. We've had commencement ceremonies. I don't know about you, but I'm still filled with so much excitement from all six of those. There was a well-deserved summer break, and I know many of you were busy working, doing research, engaging in other opportunities. And most recently, we started a new academic year together, and it was absolutely fantastic to welcome a new class of Toros. And we were very proud that they have chosen our campus for all the right reasons. And perhaps notable and most exciting is the new class of doctoral students that we have welcomed. I think that's a great reason to be proud and a great reason to applaud. We have more than 30 students in this doctoral class for occupational therapy. We also launched a new master's program for incarcerated people, Masters in Humanities. So lots to be grateful for, lots to celebrate. President Parra mentioned the historic gift from the Balmer Group. A big moment of Toro pride for all of us. And perhaps the most notable thing is that the funders were really, really interested in making sure that the vast majority of the money that they're donating is getting into the hands of students. And therefore, almost 80% of all of that funding is going directly to scholarships for future teachers who are going to be deployed into the local school districts here in the Southern California region. And then, of course, yesterday was quite the consequential vote and happening at the Board of Trustees. So together, we've had lots behind us. We have lots ahead of us. No doubt you will have a lot of questions about all of these happenings. And in just a moment, we'll make some room for you to ask these questions. Here's just a sampling of some of the conversations we've had. We've talked about space utilization and space needs. We talked a lot about the Aramark contract, our budget and the state of the budget and the different sources of revenue that we have for our budget, not just the tuition dollars, but also the state budget and other types of revenues. And we also talked about our DEIJ values and how we move collectively from not just words, but how do we make sure that these values are truly operationalized in our everyday life. And Dr. Porter, there she is, Dr. Porter gave a great update on the state of diversity, which was a historical event that took place on our campus. And it really set the standard for how we're approaching the work in the space of social justice. I want to celebrate for a quick moment the two centers that just a few weeks ago have celebrated their grand openings. We had ribbon cuttings for the API Cultural Center, which was on September 6th, and also the Women's Resource Center at the end of August. I don't know if they're here or if they're perhaps watching us online, but big congratulations to Nathan and to Megan and all the students who are going to be able to use these beautiful spaces. And if you haven't been, I encourage you all to visit them. They're remarkable, they're warm, they're welcoming, and I think they make a beautiful home for all of our students. A lot of conversations that we've had before and a lot of questions that were coming from you were centered around our dining services contract with Aramark and Urban Mosaic. So at this point, I'd like to turn it over real quick to Vice President Deb Wallace, who is going to give us a brief update on where we stand with Aramark. If you remember, previously she has shared with us a chronology of all the different steps that we have gone through in our relationship with the vendor, and Deb Wallace will have a lot more to share today.
Thank you, VP Sefchikova. So good to see everyone. Our first conversations that matter for the fall semester. I'm going to try to bring up so we are not going to run through all of this today because I want to be mindful of our schedule today. And we want to give you an opportunity to share with us some things that we might need to know as senior leadership on this campus. So we definitely want to take that opportunity. So what I will offer today is that we just run through a couple of these details since the last time we spoke. We are trying to keep the presentation very consistent. For those of you that have been going online and going on to the Conversations That Matter online, you're going to see a lot of the same framework. And for those of you that are new to the campus, welcome. But we want to make sure that we are providing that progress to the campus. I am pleased to say that Aramark, while they are not there, they have made significant progress since we had meetings last year, so I'm very excited about that. Again, I'm not going to walk through all of this, but for those of you that are brand new, to lay the frame around what we're talking about, we basically told Aramark we needed four areas of sustained and significant improvement if they're going to stay on this campus. If you look here on that left side, that first one, of course, was food quality. That was a non-negotiable for the campus. We basically said you have to improve on that. So we've given a couple of updates there. We wanted them to also really start the engagement process with our campus, with our community, as well as our students. So we provided some of those updates there, some of the things that they have done. We are constantly monitoring, and we're still meeting with them once a week because we still feel very passionate about, you know, them making sure that they sustain quality on our campus. So they've done a lot around the marketing plan, a lot around the communication plan on the campus and working with students. The financial progress, that was a huge one. And I'm going to run through a slide with that one because I think that one is very important for the campus. And then we also wanted them to improve what's going on in the human resources side of the house. They have hired, one of the things, if you remember, they weren't able to hire a chef on the campus. That was a non-negotiable for us. We said a chef is going to make sure that there is food quality, a trained and dedicated chef on the campus, so they have hired a chef that has done just amazing work with the catering events and things like that. So we're really happy about some of that progress. Again, I'm not going to run through all of this. Like I said, I will commit to putting this up on the webpage. So we have an update for you as of March. Moving forward, we also have a progress update for May. So you'll be able to see the progress from March to May. Then as we move forward, they also have made progress that they we wanted to share with you all as of this month. And I think the significant things is basically in the financial piece. So I'm going to run through that really quickly. And we wanted to show you kind of a year-over-year progress, if you will. And so we have highlighted, if you look, and we won't run through all of this, the bottom line is from last year, if you'll look, at the same time last year for the first 2 months of opening, July and August, we were running about $205,000 in the red. And that was not acceptable. We said you have to really work on either increasing some of that revenue, which the catering component of that is a huge piece, so they're doing much better on the catering side of the house, or you have to decrease revenue. So they have made significant strides on both of those. So last year around that time, still not in good shape, we really demanded that they change some of those numbers. But if you look here, this is the progress that I wanted to share. If you go from July of last year and in July of this year, you can see significant progress there. So they're tracking where we thought they would track. If you remember, we shared with you last year, the first 3 years of this contract is what we call a cost plus. So we estimated as we ramped up and moved through the contract, we knew that we were going to have some losses during the years. They came on the campus, got the temperature of how we operate during holidays, weekends, all of those things. So as you can see, there's significant progress here. So this same time last year, like I said, they were at 205,000. This time, they're at 66,000. So again, what I'd like to see is no parentheses around that number, because that means that we're still running in the negative, but not as much. So like I said, we are not there, but I feel like we are getting there. So I want to thank all of the folks that work over there with them. I see some of our students that are working over there with them. And again, we continue to meet with them. We are continuing to demand that they continue to make progress in those four areas that I described. So we will have this up for you on that Conversations That Matter website if you have any questions on that. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, VP Wallace, and I'm so glad that more people have joined us. So if you are still coming in, please take a seat. There's also food on the side. Happy to see you all, and a shout out again to those who are online. We want to make sure that we get to hear from you, because these are a conversation. So at this point, I'd like to invite our provost, Dr. Spagna, and we'll make sure to give space for your questions.
Thank you. So welcome, everybody. I'm going to try and stay here, because if I start moving around, the cameras will start having difficulty. So I'm going to stay. See Fidel. We're good. So I wouldn't be a good educator if I didn't start with something I want you to think about or maybe follow up on. If you haven't seen it, I'm a big fan of a new book that just came out. It's entitled Up Home by Ruth Simmons. If you haven't heard of Ruth Simmons, she was the first black female president of an Ivy League institution at Brown University. And in her prologue, look this up this evening, she has a great line, which I think describes what we're dedicated to here at Dominguez Hills. And the line goes like this, to paraphrase it. Without the educational opportunities that I've been afforded, I would have turned out to be the person I was supposed to be, as opposed to the person I dreamed of being. And so I start with that, and I want you to look it up if you get a chance, because I want to share what the president shared. We are in this business, so are the staff, so are the faculty, for the students. At the end of the day, your dreams are what we're trying to encourage. This is what we're trying to facilitate. So we want to open it up for things that you're all thinking about, not just students, but really privileging students and staff and faculty and others, for things that are on your mind. And I would ask several things as we do this. One is that, as the president indicated, some of the topics you're going to bring up, we might have answers to right now. Some might be things that we need to do a little more investigation into. And some we might have to learn together. We might need to be on a path together. And I remember, as we've championed our strategic plan at Dominguez Hills, it was named Going Far Together for a reason. And you know that that reason is we can go faster alone, but together we're going to have to navigate all the things we're facing in the upcoming months and the next couple years. So with that, I want to open it up for questions you have. If I could have a volunteer, would somebody raising their hand? I'll need on the panel here for someone to record some of this. Okay, so we have somebody recording it. So we'll wind up relaying this. What I want to do is get out in this exercise all the topics, the things on your mind. We're going to get all of those. I'm going to give as much time as possible for that, and then we're going to curate them in terms of what can we answer right now, what are some things we're going to need to do more investigation about, or what things are we going to have to learn together.
And we have a mic so that everybody can be heard.
Okay, great. Thank you, Dr. Franklin. So let's start. Yes.
Hold on. I'll bring the mic so make sure folks hear you.
And going off of the quote that you just told us and being who we dream to be and not who we're supposed to be, how am I going to be the person that I dream that I could be if I can't afford that dream?
Thank you. Big, big topic. Big topic, especially with the Board of Trustees meeting yesterday. Thank you. Another question.
We don't want to respond to that?
I think we're going to collect all of them.
Okay.
We're recording them so we can get, I want to make sure
okay,
we get all the topics out so we get all voices heard, and then we'll go through and curate them.
To actually add to that, why weren't any of the administrators there to support the students that have been protesting the tuition hikes? Not even just yesterday, but the day before that.
At the Board of Trustees meeting?
No, we had a protest the day before the Board of Trustees meeting.
Here on campus?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Seeing as part of the tuition increase will go towards financial aid, such as the state university grant, how will we make, the standards of receiving that state university grant here in Dominguez Hills more transparent for students so that they know, how can I get the state university grant? Why was it revoked, if they did receive it, and just like other things surrounding transparency of SUG.
Okay, thank you.
Good question.
We have a mic over there already, Dr. Franklin.
Good. Go for it.
So this one's kind of more like a nuanced issue that I've been having like with the university that I've been noticing over the past couple of years, but you know, we're increasing tuition, right? That's gonna happen, unfortunately. And obviously it's gonna continue to cost us more as like, you know, the prices go up per usual. My question is that what's the process for, because for the past couple of years, like I used to be a child development major, but I switched to psychology. And one of the reasons as to why I did switch was because we only had one professor who was available for just the specific subjects that were needed for you to get your bachelor's degree under that major. And what I'm hoping to understand is that are we, like, you know, we're, it's gonna end up costing us a lot more for tuition, and yet we're paying the same quality, we're paying for the same quality of education, and we still are, like, we're not getting the resources that we would need. So, like, to have one professor control an entire major, it just doesn't sit right with me. And obviously there's also the fact that we need to have some sort of, like, transparency and accountability in regards to, like, the professors who are here still, and obviously where they have not done the best of jobs and yet continue to be here. You know, we're paying for our education. I would at least hope to be able to, like, get the quality that is, you know, understandably for us, you know?
Okay, thank you. Important elements, really important elements. Others? Yeah.
So I have my question would be, with the tuition being raised, how does this affect the students who don't receive financial aid or the students who were reliant on financial aid and unfortunately did not receive it due to failures of grades, being that is a problem that a lot of students end up facing? I had a second question, if that is okay.
Yeah, oh, absolutely.
The second question I have is, how do you guys believe this will affect the majority of Black students when there's also a great migration going on where we're being pushed out of the central cities because of we can't afford to live here with not being able to afford to go to college in itself.
Okay.
And to be specific, even if some of those students apply for financial aid or can be granted it, there are still students who in that position cannot afford, cannot be awarded financial aid or have lost it.
Okay, thank you.
Just to add to his first question, as someone who doesn't receive financial aid and has to take out major loans in school and outside of school loans, how do you plan to keep up with community colleges who allow us to be in their community college for free, and the UCs and HBCUs that we're going to have to struggle to live in and be at anyways. If I'm struggling here, I might as well just go to one of those.
Good question. Choices of educational pathways. Other questions?
Just to add to that too, because I did notice that would be probably an issue happening later on, but what are you guys' thoughts on enrollment with regards to that? Because beforehand, I believe back in May, maybe in February, there was a little like panel that was showing that Dominguez Hills did not really meet their enrollment like requirement. Obviously, it wasn't that bad. Obviously, you know, it's like, I think about 100, maybe a little less than that. In comparison to other CSUs, and obviously with the new tuition hike that we're going to be experiencing, does that not worry you guys that a lot of students are either going to drop out or they're not going to be able to like enroll in general? Or with regards to that whole issue, like, are you not worried that enrollment's going to end up going a lot down a lot faster? Because if the quality of education is, you know, about the same in, say, like a community college, obviously, like, for me, it's too late because I'm already late. About to graduate, but say for anyone who is like going to like the lower division classes, for that it, on its own, you can literally go to a community college and it's free. So obviously that kind of defeats the whole purpose of going to a CSU type campus where it's supposed to be affordable. And if you can't really afford a CSU type education, you know, like one of the students was saying, then what is the point of going to a CSU when you could just go to a UC, get better, or at least I hope better quality of education, and then you're paying like around the same amount, even with the financial aid or without it.
So I'm hearing that two parts. One is the consequences of the tuition increase on enrollment, and then issues of quality of instruction, both very important. Others?
Right here, Mai.
I just have two. My first one is, what is the status of the food pantry? I know this was a hot topic last year, and I just wanted to see if there was any progress regarding like a permanent food pantry. And my second one is that given that President Parham has co-chaired the CSU's Black Student Success Initiative report, how will this campus continue to provide resources for Black students with the new additional funding being provided through the CSU?
Okay, both very good questions.
I'm gonna kind of piggyback off of the young man back here, the lady, and right here and here. I wasn't going to say anything, but I have to, in regards with the financial aid and the numbers, in regards with how me as myself, I'm a student, oldie but goodie. Let's just get that clear. I'm not watching. I'm very involved with the community and the students. Certain things I don't get involved with far as political-wise. I'm just not into that. But I am involved. And in regards with the financial aid, with the numbers, far as the tuition, far as beneficial, like being stuck. When I say being stuck, be able to afford to pay it back when it's time is due. If it's after commencement is what you have, like, what is it, 5 months, 6 months, the pay back if you got a loan. Also, one last in regards with the housing situation on and off campus. Some students can't afford to pay, you know, rent, cost of living constantly going up, and some students, well staffed, you know, I see it, but that ain't my business. Some, you can't sleep in their cars outside, around the blocks, at the parks. How can the university make it better and help those that to get out of that temporary struggle?
Let's have a couple more.
I don't really have an additional question. It's more of a clarification on my last one, which was how are we expected to afford it? In regards to whatever answer that you give me, I just want to say that I don't want to hear about loans. Hmm. Loans are a trap.
Right.
My mother just got her loans forgiven, and she was only in school for about a year and a half. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So whatever answer that you decide to give me, please do not let it be about loans, okay, because that's irrational and incomprehensible.
Where was she at in school?
Hmm?
Was she in a public or private
school? She went here.
So your mother has loans from here?
Yes. Okay. She just got them forgiven.
Okay.
That's a good point. One more.
Right here.
Alongside with the tuition increases, right, I've had a lot of students share really great concerns about the cost of parking permits here on campus. I don't know if there's been conversations about that, but parking permits are really expensive. $200, that's like a month of worth of groceries that our students simply can't afford.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. So we recorded these, and as I said at the outset, now we're going to turn to responding, and there are kind of three categories we talked about. One is, do we have answers right now? Are there things we need to gather? Are there things we need to work on together? We're going to crowdsource this, so as we have the responses recorded, I'm going to ask for the responses to be read out loud, the questions read out loud, and then we're going to crowdsource this. So it's the panel up here. We also have colleagues out in the audience. So I'm going to now take my seat, and we're going to crowdsource this in terms of answers to each of the questions that you so thoughtfully brought up. So if we could start, let's go through the questions, and then let's open it up in terms of some answers we can give, other things we've got to hold on to gather more information and so forth.
Provost, I'd like to start, and thank you for that, and thank you for having the courage to address the issues that are on your mind. I jotted down one, and I jotted down everybody's questions and comments, but the food pantry, because that was one that I was sharing information on and the status of that. As a matter of fact, I'd like to, for those of you that don't know her, she is the rock star of the campus, Dr. Tiffany Herbert. I don't even want to put her on the spot, but she is working very closely with my group, the facilities team, as well as our AVP of capital planning on campus. He's new to the campus, but let me tell you, when I tell you Mr. Yancey Modesto has come on this campus with a mission on his mind to really transform spaces on this campus, he's done a phenomenal job. But Dr. Herbert, I'd like you to come up because you really know that space. You've been intimate with the happenings over there and everything, and I think when we open this space up, you can tell the crowd it's going to be the best in the CSU, but I won't steal your thunder.
Well, you're right. Thanks, Deb. The food pantries, I appreciate you bringing that up, Sam. I know that this has been a topic that's been of importance to ASI for some time and to all of our community. And so immediately in response, we did open up a pantry, thank you to Dean Braisley, in the library. And we have, in the first 2 weeks of its opening, we had 2,000 students come through. So that demonstrates the need. We also opened up a satellite pantry in housing. And so that was in building in the residence hall in housing. We have the ability here in INI to provide non-perishable items. So we give those away, and we work with the farmers market and give away bags of food of non-perishable items that we store here, produce, to students every week, every Tuesday. And so these are the temporary fix to what we hope soon to be a long-term solution, which is the opening of the pantry, which will be, we're hoping, the end of October, beginning of November. And so this is across the way in the lower level is where the pantry will be located. There and so there'll be shopping style. We have little shopping carts where you can go in, you can swipe. We'll also have sort of an Instacart type online menu where you can say, I need milk, I need produce, I need toiletries. We had 6 pallets of toiletries delivered yesterday. And so that is pull-ups, Pampers, Kleenex, things like that, that we'll also be giving away in the pantry or distributing in the pantry. So despite not having the permanent space open, we are functioning a very, very, very robust pantry program. I want to just remind people, though, that the pantry is just one piece of the puzzle around basic needs for our students. And so in addition to that, we've been inviting DPSS to come to campus to enroll students into services. You don't have to go to the building anymore off campus. We're bringing DPSS here to campus on the days that you can get enrolled in Medi-Cal, you can get CalFresh, because a pantry is one day. It's one day that you can get food, but we want to try to promote stability over time so that you can have the EBT card, you can use it at the farmer's market. We can talk about transitioning from emergency housing to permanent housing. So the plan is a little bit bigger. Food pantry is one piece of the plan, but our goal is to offer more comprehensive services that offer stability around food, housing, health care, and other basic needs.
And I want to just sort of frame this in a way that I framed it with my president, and I'll just give you one of my identities. I'm sort of an empath. I feel things in ways that I probably shouldn't, and I feel them deeper and longer than the law should allow. But yesterday and the day before were difficult. When you hear the true stories of students and sending money home to parents, and trying to make ends meet, and begging, please don't increase my tuition, I probably should have turned off the Zoom or the, because not being able to get in down there was why I didn't go. But I wanted to make sure I heard everything I could hear and see everything I could see. And it impacted me. I mean, 3:30 in the morning, I'm up because the vote came and it was affirmative. And I also, to be totally candid, I also struggled with how the board struggled with making this decision. And so it was difficult. I think it was a watershed moment and so at 3:30 in the morning, I'm up thinking about, damn, we gotta do something about this. And so I asked the president, and he's already given me his, because a lot of the answers around affordability, I'm just gonna be transparent with y'all, we don't have. But I'd be damned if we go too far without getting the answers. School is unaffordable. And there are some strategies around financial aid and some strategies around scholarships that we can go a long way in terms of making sure that no student leaves Cal State Northridge because his carburetor broke down. That was my story. No student should have to do that. And I spent a year out of school because I ended up getting a job because my mom needed help. So I felt those stories yesterday in a very, very different way. And that's who, and so the president didn't hesitate. He says, yeah. I called, where Edgar? Is Edgar here? I asked Edgar. I said, dude, I need either someone from ASI to serve with me. The financial aid director is going to be a part of this with me along with Dr. Brandon. So we're going to put a task force together because how we're doing financial aid now is not going to sustain us in this new reality of 5 years of increases. We've got to be strategic. We've got to be aligned. So between ASI, I don't care, students, if you want to learn about financial aid, holler at your VP. We're about to get into this in a way that we've never studied it before. State University grant is going to be really surplused well. But if our financial aid strategies are not in place, there could be someone who need it and don't have access to it because I don't have enough financial aid counselors who are concentrating on those students and getting the information to them quickly, getting the information to them often, and connecting with them. So most of those issues, questions around financial aid, we don't have answers to be totally candid and honest. But Wait, oh, just wait. Not only are we going to have answers, we're going to have strategies, and we're going to make sure that this place is affordable. And your question around quality, I'll give that to the provost and others. But yeah, don't ask me to pay more if the quality is something that I'm questioning. And so I'm excited about, thank you, Mr. President, for giving me the green light to do this. And I hope before at Conversations That Matter, before we leave this academic year, that this task force can come back and let you know how well we understand this new tuition policy, how well we understand the new financial aid policy, and how well we're doing to make sure that no student falls through the crack, because we didn't do what we needed to do to make sure they were resourced and informed and empowered to make decisions about their education. I went longer than I wanted to, but I'm sorry I had to give you that context.
How can the university assist with housing insecurities and other issues that students are faced with?
Dr. Herber, you want to come back up? You probably should just stay here, because if you all missed our student affairs showcase, so most of y'all who are here were there, because it just allowed us, and Dr. Herbert and her team talked really well about who they are and what they do, and so go forward in terms of basic needs.
So we have revamped our structure around basic needs. So our philosophy here on campus is that basic need is not just food and shelter. Healthcare is a basic need. Psychological care is a basic need. So we have started something called Toro Care. And that is to be able to provide a coordinated system where you can call one place and get your needs met. So it used to be called CARE, and you do a CARE report, and I'll provide the links to all of this. But now you can just do a quick CARE report, and we will have a CARE coordinator call you and figure out your comprehensive needs individually. And so you don't have to go from one office to the next. You don't have to just call psych services. You call Toro Care, and you'll be connected with a care coordinator who will help you figure out what your particular needs are. And so that's not just in my cluster, but that means that care coordinator will call financial aid and help you get through the system to figure out what's going on there, work with your advisor, help you figure out what's going on with your courses, make sure that you're getting the courses that you need, and through the student success centers, because they'll be embedded in the student success centers as well. And so what we want to do is help people understand what housing options are available to them. I think that we would love to be able to provide permanent housing. But in the interim of that, we can provide emergency housing either here on campus or at a local hotel. And so where you're experiencing housing insecurity, please call Toro Care and we'll figure out how to do that. If you are placed in an emergency housing situation, we will then work with you and DPSS and other supportive services to try to transition you to either housing or other permanent housing options. I know that there are faculty, staff, and students living in their car. I understand that, and I know that. And we have actively, you may not hear the news about how these are resolved, but we are actively working with faculty, staff, and students who are living in their cars or who are unhoused at this time. And that's just one piece of the puzzle, because if you're living in your car, you also don't have food, and you also don't, it's a ripple effect on many other things.
And I'm gonna ask Dr. Herbert to also, and we'll give this to Chief of Staff Gamage. I would love for you to put the presentation that your team just gave at the showcase around Toro Care. It is comprehensive, it is nimble, it is engaging, And we've got to, I remember our former ASI president, Obioha, who would also say that information is a basic need.
Sure.
So it's great to have a great program, but if don't nobody know about it, it's not good. So I will work with AVP Myla to help us understand how to even market and understand that there are resources here, but if I don't know about them, then I can't access them. And so information is a basic need. We've got to find a way to share that. But at least you all have to look at this presentation that they gave, because it has some great resources that we have here on campus.
Sure. And if you just click the link, we'll be going to the Academic Senate. We'll put things around campus. If you click the link, then once we send it out, if you click the link, you could ask any question you want. You know, I haven't seen Tiffany in a while. I don't know where she is. Just put it in the link, and we'll figure it out. I don't know where to go for this. Just put it in the link and we'll figure it out. So any question that you have, consider Toro Care the hub, and then we will do the legwork for you to figure out where you need to go.
So I do want to address the item that Dr. Franklin brought up, which is, and I heard this a couple times, about the quality of instruction. And this is a very important thing at the university. And I will tell you that I've had experiences, and some of our faculty have had experiences teaching at the community college level, at the CSU level, at the UC level. And the one thing that we still need to uplift at every one of our universities, but particularly here at Dominguez Hills, we need to make sure that we have all of our faculty adopt the mantra that I teach the student, not the subject. Now, let that sink in, because that's a big, big, important philosophy. I teach the student, not the subject. So three things I want to add with that. One is we are upping our efforts in professional development for all of our faculty through the Faculty Development Center, through other efforts. And the one thing that we've got to pay attention to is the daily microaggressions that happen in the classroom that don't build on the cultural wealth of the students and their identities in the classroom. We are not going to get there unless we have a culturally responsive professoriate that are actually uplifting the students in the classroom. And those are not just words. We have a variety of professional development activities, and I will tell you, for the deans, department chairs, the faculty, it's not that I don't have a coalition of the willing, but remember that a lot of the faculty, in coming through their own training, they weren't necessarily trained in how to be good teachers. They were trained in how to know their subject, but they weren't necessarily trained in how to be effective teachers. So we got to up our game on that. We got to up our game severely on that. So we're committed to that. I also want to let you know, one of the reasons why I spent my entire career, 30 plus years in the Cal State system, is the Cal State system privileges teaching above all else. And I will tell you, this president, myself, the deans, we have faculty that do not get promoted. We have faculty that do not get entitlements if we see that their teaching has been poor over a long period of time. We'll do interventions, we'll try and help, but unlike the UCs in particular, we do not let people continue if they are ineffective in the classroom. So that's an assurance you have. And then the final thing is that I want to say that there is a modern challenge that we have for our faculty, which is they not only now have to be good instructors, they have to be good members of a care team. They can't just teach in the classroom. They have to be able to connect with Tiffany. They have to be connected with student affairs, because they have to address multiple issues in the classroom. It's not just teaching. If I see a student in distress, what am I doing to get that student help? They have a responsibility that way. And I will tell you, everything you heard from this president, I'm singing to the choir here. In every one of his addresses with faculty, as recent as yesterday, he's reinforcing that you can't give up on these students. If you see a student struggling, you've got to go the extra mile on this front. So we're doing that as well as coordinated care. So I want to address a little bit of that. I will say one thing, that when we compare the three segments of public higher education, I'll put my money behind the Cal State system in terms of whether or not we have the most effective teachers. But we can get even better on that front, so I wanted to address that in terms of quality of instruction. From a time check, I think we've got until 4, so we had a couple other issues that came up that I want to make sure we get to in terms of the agenda. Justin?
We got to 4:30, I think.
4:30 for this?
Yes.
Well, for this segment, and as
segment
we're into what's on your
four.
Mind.
Yeah.
But I want to, again, thank everybody for their comments, but let me see if I can't jump in and add some texture to what it is we say. I admire the first question, which is, how do you expect us to dream if we can't afford it? I think it's a legitimate question and one we struggle with. I want to make sure you watch your clock, because I know Dr. Nguyen is coming up. Tell him I said hello, by the way. One of my heroes, Langston Hughes, reminds us all the time that we should hold fast to the dreams we have, for if they die, life is just a broken-winged bird that cannot fly. What we try to do here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills is prevent wings from breaking. And as you heard Dr. Herbert just wax and wane, we try to mend those that do break, unfortunately. But affording a dream is a different space, because part of what you have to do is be able to take a risk on the campus. And I share the pain that Dr. Franklin felt. I've been in it a lot longer than yesterday in the last 2 days, because we've been struggling with this for the last years. But I can tell you on the other side that the storms, I think, that are coming to higher education have an ability to deplete excellence, deny access, and make higher education more unaffordable, right, than some parts of it are. And no one, I think, around that board, and I know all of them personally, gets up in the morning and says, how can I vote for tuition increases on students? It pains us. But I can tell you for sure, when I went to, I'm a product of growing up in LA. I ain't nothing but a regular old homeboy from around the way. I understand what it's like to be poor, like Dr. Franklin, who talked about his own economic challenges. I grew up in a family with a mom who raised 4 kids by herself. Never earned more than $18,000 in a single year. And that was only the last 3 years she worked for the federal government. Bless her soul in heaven. I know what poor looks like. And we found a way to make it. But what's also true is California at that point had zero, let me say that again, zero tuition. So for those who are history buffs, go back and look. Don't trust anything I'm about to tell you. Go back and look it up yourself. Zero tuition. And what's happened over the years is that the state has disinvested in public higher education. So that we've now done this, so that what the state used to pay at all, they've done this. And so now what students and families pay and the state pays kind of buffers in here. So we play this game with each other and in the news that has us going back and forth about who's the culprit about this. So we got students who run on presidents, you know, appealing, who run on chancellor's offices and trustees, as if somehow they get up every morning saying, how can we raise tuition on students? They don't. But what you also heard is that the state has not given us the resources we need to be able to function. And while the tuition increase is tragic, even at 6%, which amounts to a little over $300 in a year for this year coming up in 24-25, what it means is you see state officials standing there going, what more can you do with your resources that you already have, knowing that we don't have the resources? So the question we have to interrogate as administrators and US students, this real talk now, is if we don't raise tuition, what are you prepared to give up? You just talked about, thank you for your question. How do I go into a section where I got one faculty member in the space? Because what we're trying to do, this provost and I, we, is raise the tenure density. On most campuses that we have, right, in the system, when I come out of the Ivy League as a professor of the UC, if I got 1,000 faculty, I guarantee you 650 of them are full-time tenure track, and 350 of them are part-time. At Dominguez Hills and in most of the Cal States, they're reversed. Why is that? Because UC gets funded in a way that we don't, and because it has auxiliary enterprise it can rely on when the state doesn't give it what it's needed. It has hospitals and residence halls and dining that it can pull dollars from to be able to get that done. We don't. So when they underfund us, it really hurts. It means we have fewer faculty. It means we have more adjuncts. How many of you students who are here get taught by adjunct faculty who are not full-time folk? Lots of you, right? And some of them you don't even know are adjunct faculty. We are trying to improve the tenure density, but it takes resources to do that. Not having the funds means we have fewer faculty, so section numbers go up. We have fewer sections. We have fewer faculty like you just talked about, right? Thank you for that observation. where we got one or two faculty in a space where we don't have sufficient enrollment to be able to do that. It is a crazy situation to be in. I can also tell you, much like we did in the Lunch and Learns, that there are two primary sources of funding we get on this campus out of seven, right? Five of them are Clown Auxiliary with reserves, et cetera, et cetera. I'm gonna get to that in a second. They are state allocations and tuition. If the state is not giving us what we want and we rely on tuition, that's important. And the observation is true, our enrollment numbers are going down. We knew the cliff was coming. This has been nationally happening. But it's accelerated on the heels of COVID. It hasn't been a problem for Dominguez Hills. Why? Because we were always over-enrolled. We always had thousands more students than we were funded for as a funding target by the CSU system and the state. And what's happened over the last couple of years is our funding is now going down because our enrollments are doing this. And so now when we're right at this cliff here, so we have two things to worry about, the two alligators out there in the water lurking. One is the state that says, if you're not making enrollment target, then we potentially cut your funding even more than they're already cutting it. The second is the Chancellor's Office has made a rule that says the folk who are underfunded, under-enrolled, I should say, are now in the X category. So if you are 10% or more under-enrolled, we are now about to take 5% of your budget. If you are in the Y category, you're right at enrollment or not quite 10% under, we're going to give you a yellow card, but that's a caution. And if you're in the Z category, that means you're over-enrolled, which is the way we used to be, and we're going to actually take the money from over here and give it to you so that you can fund the students that you have. So not only do we have to worry about the enrollment cliff and not meeting target, we have to worry about whether or not we're losing money. Now, the state of your Dominguez Hills as of today, we were fortunate in that we got an extra 2.68, what? $2.6 million extra because of our enrollment. It's just a hair over where it should be, which is wonderful. But we don't know that we can spend that on real money. Why? Because if we don't meet enrollment target next year, that's about to get cut. So we have to treat that new money like it's temporary. That's what's happening with that. And so we don't have tuition dollars. The CSU system as a whole in your campus is in the red, something like $1 billion. That's how underfunded we are. And so even with the tuition increases, even with what the state gives us, it doesn't allow us even to close the gap. And when you add philanthropy, when you add folks, that's what we're trying to do. So I want us to think about, even as it pains us to think about supporting tuition. I walked into a student meeting the other day that said, would you support tuition increase? Yes, I would. Not because I love raising tuition on students, but because I understand at a 30,000 foot level the implications of not having the extra dollars we need to fund faculty. We got faculty out on the line, students are supporting, who say, I want a 12% raise when the system has offered them 2% because that's what it can afford. So let me give you the real math. You want some real talk? Every 1% over that 2% that we go is about a $50 million hit to the system. And you just heard the legislators, including the lieutenant governor, stand up and say, I hope you have the resources internally to manage your affairs. What are they telling you in real talk? We are not coming to your rescue. So if we argue for 6%, 8%, 10% raises, that's 8% over the 2%. Multiply that 8 by $50 million, and what do you have? We are $400 million in the hole. That is more than the budget of this entire institution and 10 or 15 others in the CSU system. The dollars aren't there. Why? Not because we don't want it, not because Dean Traeger's not trying to create more grants, not because Deb Wallace is not managing the funds well. It's because the state has disinvested in public higher education. And might I get in trouble for saying that? Fine. That's real talk. So the culprit is not us. I wish somehow we would quit fighting with each other and acting like somehow we aren't on each other's side and we would coalition to go to the state to say, stop disinvesting in public higher education so we can fund our students, fund our faculty, compensate our staff the way they should be compensated, and put facilities in place that students deserve. How big is our backlog on deferred maintenance? We have a deferred maintenance backlog on this campus right now. Tony Jakes, how big? $300
million? Almost
$500 million. We've been begging for money from the state, even with the new buildings we have. And what do they do? Just plug in the ear, because we haven't seen it. Affordable housing. One of the things we're trying to do is create affordable housing. I got a grant that we applied for with Compton College. We're trying to create a pathway to both boost enrollment, but also get a grant, because if we can build the housing with a grant from the state, then we don't have to, right, charge as much rent that we need to be able to afford it. Housing is auxiliary enterprise, so whenever we build something new, it's nice to have new housing, but we got debt on the housing that has to be paid by the students. The state does not pay for housing, even though we could make it. Parking was a question. Parking is auxiliary enterprise. Parking has to pay for itself. So every road that gets paved, every stall that gets put in, it is an auxiliary enterprise. One of the things I would love to have are three parking structures, because you guys also complain, rightly so, about we don't have sufficient parking. Now, by the way, there is sufficient parking. It's just not convenient, because everybody wants to be here or there, right? We do have parking at other places, but you need structures. I believe it too. But we should have a space that allows us to be able to do that. When I'm at a place like Irvine, when it wants to build new housing, and its footprint's about 50%, it goes to its reserves in housing and says, let's just put in, right, another $10 or $15 million to put down on housing, and we'll just have a bond measure or, right, a mortgage that will do it based on what the students can pay. For us, we don't have sufficient reserves. If the roof leaks, if the pipe breaks, which is done, if the landscape is not quite work, if the soil is done, if the patios are breaking, if whatever, we do not have sufficient reserves to do that and bring in a couple $1,000s to be able to work with it. That's the kind of shape that we're in. So we're trying to do the best we can with the limited resources we have to be able to get it done. So when we think about trying to dream about being in the space, what I'm excited about, at least in this particular space, which is new for this system, is the return to aid formula. So what that means is that for every dollar that tuition goes up in this case, one third of it comes off the top to go into return to aid. And that is what Dr. Franklin was talking about in terms of it's going to create a more robust financial aid formula that will not impact the students who are already 100% covered. There are some students we have on the campus and in the system that won't pay a dime of that increase. But there's some in that 30 or 40% whose grants are going to be there, whose other stuff is going to be there, that we're going to have a more robust financial aid package to be able to divert more money there. That's good news. And I'll also say this respectfully, and I want to say this to all the students and the faculty staff, because I heard a student make a plea to say, don't tell me, I don't want to hear nothing about loans. As your president, my job is not to tell you what you want to hear. My job is to tell you what you need to know. And even as poor as I was, one of the best investments I made in myself was taking out a loan that has 3% interest. You don't have to pay it back as long as you're in school. And your trajectory with a college degree goes like this compared to folk without one. And so when you think about the jobs you can have, we are lauded right now on one poll for being second in the nation for social and economic mobility. Our students are getting jobs, getting good jobs that can pay. So if you can get a degree and get a job and get out of some of the classes with some of our faculty and get your degrees, there are jobs you can take that will allow you to pay back the investment. The loan is not about just cost. The loan is about what am I prepared to invest in my future. Who among us, doesn't matter how much money you make, can go out and buy a house cash money? Anybody? What do? We take out a loan. The other most expensive purchase most of us will have, who drives a car in here? Who drives a vehicle? How'd you afford it? With a loan. We take out loans to afford the things that we invest in. Because why? Because they allow us access to do some other things. So I get that we are discouraged from being able to take out loans. And there's some folk that I wouldn't encourage to do that. But what I don't want to do is get us into the habit of thinking that loans somehow have this bad issue. It is one of the best investments you can make in yourself, because you'll have the ability to do that. And by the way, the reason I asked about where her parent went is because the national zeitgeist is talking about these institutions around the country that saddle students with enormous debt. We know students with $100,000 and $200,000 worth of debt that is just like nutty. Going to private schools, people taking advantage of them, and then the degrees aren't worth the paper they're written on, so they have a hard time getting it, which is why some folks are getting yanked by the Department of Education and other folk, and even sued by the criminal justice system to be able to navigate that space. But if you look at the CSU statistics, we have one of the lowest loan ratios. There are 60% of our students, I think the number is 60%, who graduate with no debt, none. And those who do have debt, the debt is usually, for most of them, less than about $7,000 to $10,000 over the course of their whole time. And think about a 40-year career you have, making whatever money you would make, you could pay that back as an investment. So I'm not arguing that we need to create nothing but loans. We don't. If we can give grants, which is why the sub-grants will be grants. But I don't want us to develop the mindset that somehow there's something bad about loans. It's an investment in yourself. And I just happen to believe that you students are worthy of yourself. You deserve to invest in yourself. Lastly, I'll say, because I think some of the other things on here that were important, do I think it'll have a deliberate impact on black students? They were asking me this the other day. I've not seen the data. The scientist in me says, look at the data. And I've seen tuition go up and, you know, a number of times. I've not seen it have necessarily a detrimental impact on that. As far as community colleges, are they free? Yes. They get subsidized in ways in which we don't. Why? Because they have bond measures. So community college is part of the K-14 system, right? So you can go to community college for free or $1,500, whatever it is. Okay. Except the quality of the education you get in a community college, I wouldn't say is comparable. When you can work with a Dr. Schrager in her research lab, right, in her academic discipline, or with a Professor Krogman in physics, and you need that experience with a professor on a campus like this, right? You can work in speech communications, you can work in psychology, you can work in whatever disciplines we are, in FAM with Dr. Gammage, you can work in nursing with Misu Kim and her team. Now you have recommendation letters so that when you go to grad school and people say, well, what do you have to show for that? You will not have 2-3 years after you get past that general ed to be able to get that done. When you come in as a community college with a transfer student, you have missed all of that. You have missed it. The quality of the educational experience for our students is not as good as you can have on a CSU campus. I'm like the provost. I would put the CSU up against anybody. And even being a UC snob, I was educated in the UC with a UC degree. But this is the best job I've ever had. Why? Because I'm real talk. I've been in spaces where universities judge their worth by selectivity ratios and how many students we can keep out. We only admitted the top 4%. Isn't that wonderful? How many folk who come to the CSU and Dominguez Hills are getting admitted to UCs where they're saying, we want you? One of the things we pride ourselves on here is access. And we are giving folk access. I got some 4.3 students on this campus, some of which I mentor. There's not a year that goes by I don't have 4 or 5 students on my calendar every week seeing, mentoring, advising them. But we got some 2.3 students here trying to be 2.5s. I want them too. And the UCs don't want them. Some of even the Cal States don't want them. I want them because I know there's too much talent up in there. And we will try to make the educational experience excellent. We will try to give you access that some folk don't want to give you and try to keep it as affordable. When I was at Irvine, we took in 116,000 applications for 4,420 spots, and an average GPA was 4.3. You got a 4.0 and still can't get in. I'm not trying to be that kind of educator. I can take a 4.0 student, keep him or her 4.0. That's easy. What I want is that student who has the potential. That's why this is that soil, right, that we are trying to cultivate the garden that is your intellectual potential. And we're going to do our best and try to keep it as affordable, try to produce the excellence, and try to make sure that we give you the access that you need to get in. Dr. Gammage, you got the floor.
Yes, so we have another question from a student on the floor.
Hi.
Hey, you.
Hi, Dr. Parham. How's everybody doing today? I think Trustee Melina Mancio and Aguilar Cruz said it best. We provide an experience that no other system does. The CSU serves diverse and underrepresented communities because we're affordable with quality education and referred to as a gem by the governor. Why are we not doing more to advocate to the state for more funding system-wide? I understand that we need money, but I know that no one here, staff, faculty, or admin, wanted it to be on the backs of students, the greatest stakeholders and most vulnerable population. What advocacy efforts are being done to persuade the state to continue funding the CSUs from the presidents, from the trustees? And if there isn't, can there be?
So let me, I'll throw out an answer to that, and very poignant, that question, really important question. And I want to be conscious of our time because we do have a 4:30 hard stop. And I want to say that we're going to address this last question, but Vice President Sefcikova has been excellent about keeping continuity. So as a conversation that matters, we're not going to come the next time we meet and start from scratch. We're going to take a lot of these forward, as you heard a lot of people addressing it. So I'll just give you the perspective that joint advocacy with the state is huge. It's very important. But as long as we keep coming as a higher ed system with our hands out and saying, give us more, it's not going to be effective. Instead, what we need to do is, you heard the president announce at the start, we need to cultivate more friends of Dominguez Hills. We need more people like the Ballmer Group saying, we're going to give you $22.1 million. We need people like Toyota and Apple saying, we're going to pay for pathways for students to go. If we can, and there are a lot of friends of the university, we need them to pay for students to come loan-free, tuition-free to the university. We're going to guarantee you jobs. And then once we get those friends cultivated, and we will do this here at Dominguez Hills, then we're going to have those friends go up to Sacramento, not Dominguez Hills, and say, where would we be without Dominguez Hills? They are economically driving the whole South Bay. That's the right strategy. And we tend not to do that in the CSU. But like the state of Maryland, they did this about a decade ago. And guess what? The state started funding them again, not because higher ed went to Maryland and the legislature, because the businesses went to the legislature and said, you better do this or we're going to lose money in the state. So I know that's it. I don't want to be oversimplified, but we're going to have to change our strategy. There are a lot of people with their hands out at the state. We're going to have to be more sophisticated.
Jayden, we also have to listen. There's a national movement that the CSU is going to have to get more engaged in. We're going to have to get more engaged in. We have got to double Pell Grant. 50 years ago, Pell Grant literally covered more than two-thirds of the tuition. Today, it only covers about a third. So doubling Pell Grant and doubling down in terms of making sure, yeah, we need to, I'm with Mike, we need to do both and. We need to stay at the legislature's feet. And I was going to say another anatomy part, but we don't want to be on their necks. But certainly we need to be there. And we got to advocate because at the end of the day, we also have to talk about how predatory loans have been. There's a reason why I called him a doctor. It's Dr. Jill Biden. He's not Dr. Joe Biden. But there's a reason why all of those loans are being forgiven. The federal government was pretty predatory. And as people of color have moved into higher education, state investments have left. And as women and people of color have come into higher education, oh, but the folks who preceded us didn't have to take out loans, because the state had more of an investment. But as women and people of color come into higher education, so we've got to keep this thing real and make sure that, because we're driving California's economy, not the UC system, to the extent that we are in the CSU, and this is a good investment, but we got some fighting ahead, and we're gonna think global, but we're gonna act local. We got some things that we can do here too, so that if a student is gonna take out a loan, it's a last resort, because this financial aid packet, their financial aid packet, is so robust, and some of the great work that, if you all have not met Tom Sales, who's somebody who's going to be, but we want to make sure that our university dollars and our scholarship dollars are so good that a loan is the last thing you need, and it may be never needed if we get our act together at CSU Dominguez Hills, and that's what we're committed to do.
And our job as educators is not just what you get in the classroom of students, it's to provide that support of how do I handle a loan? How do I manage this so you graduate with no debt and no loans? So we're going to up our game on that front as well. Right. I know in terms of time, I'm going to turn it to the president to be able to go through the strategic priorities. We had four. We now have added a fifth as of last night. And then we're going to turn it to our Vice President, Sevcikova, to sum up as we do in conversations that matter.
Yeah. And again, thanks for the question. And loving that. It's surprising, I think, that we would have student trustees ask the question about what more advocacy can we do, since I have been with both of them up on the Hill in Sacramento multiple times, arguing with state legislators about what we need. What the state is prepared to do for us is give us what they're comfortable giving. What I want folk to ask is, what is the correlation between what it takes to run an institution like this, or any institution in DeKalb State, and the amount of money that they're giving us? And more importantly, in my standard, what does it take to produce excellence? And what's the correlation between that excellence we want to produce and the money they're giving us? You'll find that it's missing. So we are still advocating. We are still out trying to raise money. We are going to more breakfast, lunches, and dinners, and you can count trying to raise money. And by the way, unless you think the state is not listening to us, because your president has a pretty loud voice, as you can surmise, right? Anybody remember how we got a down payment on a new rec center state's never built? $20 million. Anybody remember how we got $20 million to build, upgrade the new power grid? Because we're out of power, right? That's the legislature. Anybody know how we got $20 million to build a new dining hall? Anybody know how we got another $15 million this year that's going to help us build some affinity centers for real and help the Dimerly Center out? Those are legislators coming to our rescue to do that. So Dominguez Hills is screaming at folk and being able to do that. And this whole team is engaged in being able to do some of that work. Having said that, let me say, as well as our student trustees, by the way, who are on those trains with us, right, making that happen. When we think about this year and priorities, what I've told the team, and the team have told their directors and assistant vice presidents, is that we have four priorities this year, and after yesterday, we now have five. So I can tell you for sure, priority number one this year will be student retention. The question is not how many more students can we recruit, even though we want to continue to recruit them, but how many can we retain? If we just retained a larger share of the students than we lose every year, we would be fine enrollment-wise. So that is going to be our number one priority. And I have talked to the faculty, I talked to the Academic Senate yesterday, for those who might have had a chance to peek in on that. And I talked to the Senate yesterday, even at the trustee meeting, to the statewide Senate. And I reminded them that students are not flunking out of affinity centers or basic needs centers or mental health centers. They are flunking out of our classrooms. So I need our faculty to be engaged with student affairs, with AMBS, with everybody as a team effort to be able to work together to help us get into these spaces. So we're going to try to do that. Retention and enrollment are key, number one priority. Number two.
Mr. President, if I could also add, and this please. Is very important, it still rings true that if you have a college degree, you will make four times as much in your lifetime than you would if you just had a high school diploma. But if you don't graduate from college and take on debt, then that works against you. So that's why retention is so important, to get you through and get you the degree.
Right, it's that investment. Our second priority this year will be tenure density. So we heard you long before we heard you, right? And so the tenure density numbers here, we've tried to still stay true to the academic mission and producing the excellence. By the way, right now, and we've upped the standard, and Dean Nguyen, where did I see Dean Nguyen? So I pointed him out the other day because, and I shared this story real quickly. The provost and I kind of had a come to Jesus moment with the faculty in this college about producing excellence and getting it accredited. And I threatened him.
Well, yeah. It wasn't a threat.
Wasn't a threat?
It was an expectation.
It was an expectation. I think that's a good way to massage it. That we can either produce excellence, or I'm going to take the resources and I'm going to put them in another place that's going to produce the excellence I expect on this campus when I arrive. And doggone it if they didn't rise to the task and things. So now they are AACSB accredited for the first time in 27 years. And all the other campuses or departments that have now followed suit from journalism to music to information creative science, who just got, and all these others that we've had. We now have the most accredited programs we've ever had in the history of this campus. That is the academic excellence we're trying to produce, but we can't sustain that unless we do something about continuing tenure density. So we're going to allocate our resources to be able to help support that as well. Thirdly, we are going to try to stand up and support our digital sophistication. CARES funding and HERS saved us. Everybody said, just pivot, COVID's here. 50% of our students didn't even have devices or hotspots. We stood it up, fortunately CARES funding came, but as now you have that infrastructure in place, you've got to be able to sustain it. So we have about a $12 million, right? Gap we're trying to do, we can maybe stand it up with a couple million dollars here or there. So we're still way behind the eight ball, but we've got to be able to sustain our digital sophistication so that classrooms like this are smart for students to be able to do, faculty have the resources they need to be able to teach and discover and create, and we're able to do that space. And Dean Schrager, she motivates all of her folk who's just killing the game right now, right, to move in and create more grant funding for our faculty who are some intellectual superstars. And now they're beginning to produce the way in which we should have been producing all along. That's this exciting news. But the digital sophistication has to be in place to be able to help them do that and help our students learn. So that's going to be priority three. Priority number four is going to be standing up a brand new division of diversity, equity, inclusion, and social justice, right? We have too long on this campus been passive participants to our own social justice history. And with the hiring of Dr. Porter and the work that she's done, and you saw her lay out in that beautiful town hall that she put together, the template for what real diversity is going to look like authentically on the campus, we've got to be able to both stand up that division and be able to implement it. Diversity is not simply her job. It is all of our job to be able to support. And so we need our staff, our faculty, and our students involved in embracing that initiative. And the fifth priority we've just named today, as Dr. Franklin mentioned, is scholarships and affordability and how we can do a deep dive on some of both the financial aid piece and find out, right, what does the data really say about what's affordable and how do we help sustain those folk, particularly those who are too affluent to be poor, but they're too poor to be affluent. Those are the folk in the middle who don't have much aid, or we want to try to minimize loans. So we're going to go to work on diving in on trying to do that. And those are going to be our priorities for the year. So I want to close my remarks before I turn it back over to Vice President Sashikova and say, remind us that we are all in this together, y'all. We take tremendous pride in this institution, and I hope you do the same. We get up every day salivating at the thought of coming to work, making a difference in the lives of our students, our faculty, and our staff. So as you're out there, I know it makes nice theater to be able to hoorah and talk about who does what, but real talk, we're all in this together. What I need as your president is I need your help. I need your support. If you're into praying, we could use your prayers, because we got to go advocate to the state and to some of these other folk. But between the dollars we're able to pull in, between the donors we're attracting, between the new range of things, we got new stuff we can't even roll out yet because it's on the horizon. We're kind of doing, everybody's taking a look at Dominguez Hills. But what we can't do is turn on each other in ways in which are not going to be productive and don't put the best foot forward in terms of the image we want to create for the external stakeholders outside who are prepared to invest in us. For Ballmer to step up, not just own the Clippers and build new arenas, but say, I got $22.1 million to invest in CSUDH. That's a pretty, right, big standard right there. What we want to do is be worthy of that investment and be able to cultivate some more. So with that, Vice President Sashikova, you got the mic. I appreciate y'all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. And I want to go real quick back to that very first question that a student asked, because that one hit me in the heart. And the question was, how can I afford to be the person I dream to be? And I don't think that student is in the room anymore, but I want to speak directly to her and to so many others just like her, because I know she's not the only one struggling with this. you are not alone. You are not alone. And the president and others have mentioned some of the partners and some of the funders, some of the donors who dream the same dreams for you that you are dreaming for yourself as our students. And you know, part of that big gift that we just got, the $22.1 million, that was a process that took us about a year and a half. And I know I speak for everybody on that team, and there was a lot of people involved in that journey. It was a year and a half of dreaming together with the donors about what it takes to be, for instance, in this particular project, a teacher in Southern California. And they had the same concerns that our future teachers do: student loan debt, affordability, accessibility. The scholarship awards that we're going to be able to give out range from $2,500 all the way to $10,000. That's huge. So please know that you're not alone and that are others who believe in you. The future for Dominguez Hills is really, really bright when it comes to these kinds of investments. Our partners, our funders see us as a place that can change lives and that sets you up for success. And on behalf of the entire advancement team and every division on this campus, we are committed and we're doubling our efforts to make sure that you don't have to ask yourself that question every day. How can you afford to be who you dream to be? And I'm still dreaming about who I want to be. And that when I grow up, I hope to be just like our students, because you are amazing and you deserve the best. I want to recap real quick about what we heard you say today. We heard, and perhaps no surprise, a lot from students primarily. We heard about the struggles. And it was very obvious to all of us when we watched the public comments at the trustee meeting yesterday. We heard the passion, we heard the voices. This is not only about the tuition increase. It is about all the costs that come with getting a college education. You told us today that we're still lacking with some of the instructional resources that you need. The cost of food, the cost of parking is still a big issue. You want to see more transparency around access to financial aid, all sorts of financial aid, not just scholarships, not just the state university grants, but other types as well. We have to do a lot more education around all the resources that are available, and you need us to provide more comprehensive services, not just one-time band-aids. You're concerned about the impact of this recent tuition increase on enrollment, and I think that's really going to fall into that category of we're going to have to learn this one together. We have a sense and we have a lump in our throat about what that might mean, but we've got to do some more work together to figure out what that exactly looks like. And I also want to mention that in one of the last sessions we promised you, and you asked more about the different sources of revenue that we have on this campus, and that goes back to your question, Jaden, about what are we doing together to advocate for more resources on this campus. So these are just the highlights. We've all taken some really good notes. We're going to go back. We're going to refer to them. We're going to continue the hard work together with you. And I want to remind everybody, we have a website. If you go to the homepage, you click on the accountability and transparency website. Please check it. The recording of today's session will be posted. Check it also for the slides that were shared today, so you'll be able to refer to them. And then also check that webpage for the next date of when we're all going to get together. And lastly, when you think about new topics, new things you want to ask about, you want to have those conversations about things that matter to you, again, on that website, pop in the question. Those go all directly to our chief of staff. We'll make sure to record them for next time and include them in our conversations that matter. So with all that said, thank you to all of you today in the room. We have quite a full room here today. And thank you to everybody online who's been watching. Thank you for staying with us. Until next time.
Thank you.